Good Easter morning, Calvary family, and everybody else joining us here on our video worship on this beautiful Easter morning. So glad that you are here. Wow, do we wish that we were all together in our sanctuary, warm and snuggly, but we hope you're warm and snuggly in your living room or wherever you're watching this. Get a cup of coffee and gather the family around, and let's worship our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We've got some great worship that's going to be happening this morning, classic Easter songs and new ones as well, and some great truth coming from God's Word about the truth of the resurrection that we believe will encourage you during these crazy times that we live in. Let me read the Easter story for you, the way that it happened a couple thousand years ago, from the book of Matthew chapter 28. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to view the tomb. There was a violent earthquake because an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and approached the tomb. He rolled back the stone and was sitting on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards were so shaken by fear of him, they became like dead men. The angel told the woman, "Don't be afraid, because I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, just as he said. Come, see the place where they lay him, and then go quickly and tell his disciples. He is risen from the dead, and he is indeed going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Listen, I've told you." So, departing quickly from the tomb, with great fear and great joy, they ran to tell his disciples the good news. Just then, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." They came and they took hold of his feet and they worshiped him. And then Jesus told them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to leave for Galilee. They will see me there." Ah, so, so good. Let's worship our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Good morning, church. So glad you're celebrating with us this Easter Sunday. Let's join together in worship.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, Alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high, Alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply, Alleluia. Lives again our glorious King, Alleluia. Where, O death, is now thy sting? He died, our souls to save, Alleluia. Where's thy victory, O grave, Alleluia. Love's redeeming work is done. Thought the Battle in the grave. anointed King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive. Sting, our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome. Forever He is glorified, forever He is lifted.
We gather to worship because forever He will reign. And we sing hallelujah, which literally means praise God. And we sing it forever and ever in anticipation of finally seeing Him face to face one day. As we prepare to hear the word of God, let's go before Him in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank You again for this beautiful Easter resurrection morning. Father, no matter the chaos that is happening in the world, You reign, and You reign forever, and not a single thing happens that You are not sovereignly in control of, and we praise You for that. We praise You for coming into situations where there is death, and You bring life. We praise You for coming into our trouble and our chaos, and calming the storm and the seas. We praise You for being the resurrection and the life, and we so need that. We need You to be our life today. Father, we come before You now to listen to the teaching of Your word, and we pray that You would open our eyes to see great things in Your word. Open our ears to really hear what You have to say to us. So, Father, bless Pastor Jeff as he brings the word today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's listen.
Hello, everybody. This is Resurrection Sunday, and if we were all together in a normal Sunday service that we've all been used to, I would say, He is risen. And you, of course, would reply back to me, He is risen indeed. So, I'm going to say it, and at home, say it. He is risen. Amen. I am Pastor Jeff Harrington, and today on this Resurrection Sunday, I'm going to be preaching out of the book of Acts, chapter 13, verses 16 through 33, and the title of the sermon is, It's the Truth. And for the Christian faith, the resurrection is the most important aspect of our faith. Everything rises and falls on the truth of the resurrection. And it makes the Christian faith completely different than every other faith there is. In fact, if you were to give an analogy or even an illustration of how other faiths are built, it would be in a pyramid form. And you would be able to pull out a block here and there, and that pyramid would stay up. But Christianity is inverted. The pinnacle is actually the bottom. The point's touching the ground. That point is the resurrection. And if you pull out the resurrection, all the claims of Christianity collapse on itself. That makes it completely different than everything else. The resurrection is the demonstration of God's active and pursuing love of his creation. It is the deliberate decision of God to initiate a permanent remedy for the eternal consequences of us falling short of his standards. It is the loving kindness of our Lord God to bridge the chasm that's formed, the separation that's formed between us and him because of our sin. And as I said earlier, everything stands on the validity of Jesus' resurrection. In fact, Scripture even addresses that when the Apostle Paul writes to us. He says, "And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people the most to be pitied." Wow. To be pitied if this isn't correct. Yet, that's what we stand on. And if you're listening today and this has been something you've been processing, the words of Tim Keller really echo for you. It says, "If Jesus Christ rose from the dead, then you have to accept all that he said. If he didn't rise from the dead, then why worry about any of what he said? The issue on which everything hangs is not whether or not you like his teaching, but whether or not he rose from the dead." And that's where we're at today. That's what this day is all about. It is a completely futile and pitied day if this didn't happen, or if you believe in it and have faith in it and you know it's the truth, then it is a day that your life changes. The story I'm going into is written, is reflecting a preaching of the Apostle Paul. Now, in the Bible, he's called Paul and Saul. They're not different names, actually. Saul is just the Hebrew version, and Paul is the Greek version of his name. Paul, to set this up, began his career as a Pharisee, a Jewish Pharisee, and when Christianity was starting to take hold, he was very aggressive in persecuting the church. He literally supervised executions and went out and he himself gathered people and threw them into prison to be executed for the faith. And then on the way to on one of these journeys, he meets the resurrected Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus. And there his life is radically turned around. And as he's preaching, not everybody had this news. They didn't have social media, wasn't on TikTok, wasn't on Snapchat. It was just the word of mouth was going around. And as he's preaching, this is the response to him early on. It says, "All those who heard him were astonished and asked, 'Isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on this name,'" that would be Jesus, "'and hasn't he come here to take us prisoners to the chief priests?'" They hadn't learned yet that he had completely turned his way. And I want you to pay attention. This was, I mean, not, he was an enemy of the church. He was trying to destroy the church. And it's a reminder that all of us who have rejected Christ, just as I did my first 30 years of life, complete rejection, that for while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son. How much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? And so we see the deliberateness God chooses about his enemies, those of us who rejected him. And we see that he does this out of his own love. In fact, the scripture says, God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While I was doing all the things that I did, while you were doing all the things that you did, Christ died for you, knowing that that's what you needed from him. He even did that for those who would continue to reject him. So as we go into this story in Acts, let's see how Paul is presenting this truth of the resurrection. And so he's at an assembly in a synagogue where he would go. And the way that would go is they would do teaching. And if there was a guest there who they knew was a teacher, he would be asked to speak if he wanted to. So that's the scenario. So this is where we start. Standing up, Paul motioned with his hand and said, "Fellow Israelites and you Gentiles who worship God, listen to me. The God of the people of Israel chose our ancestors, and he made the people prosper during their stay in Egypt. With mighty power, he led them out of that country. For about 40 years, he endured their conduct in the wilderness, and he overthrew seven nations in Canaan, giving their land to his people as their inheritance. All this took about 450 years. After this, God gave them judges until the time of Samuel, the prophet. Then the people asked for a king, and he gave them Saul, son of Kish, of the tribe of Benjamin, who ruled 40 years. After removing Saul, he made David their king. God testified concerning him, 'I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do.'" And what we see Paul doing, and for those of you who are listening who maybe haven't found faith yet, it's the importance of the whole scripture. Paul is using what we call the Old Testament, which would probably be better said to be the First Testament of God, to show the truth of Jesus' resurrection. All that God, the character of God, all through this process. In fact, there's a statement that's from an early church father named St. Augustine, who said the New Testament is the Old Testament concealed, and the Old Testament is in the New Testament revealed. In other words, they work together to show us the totality of the picture of God. That everything in the Old Testament is in the New Testament, but it just wasn't understood quite yet. And then when you read the New Testament, you see the Old Testament coming alive, realizing they're working together in conjunction to show us the truth of God and the truth of the resurrection. So what I'd ask you to consider to understand is that all of the Bible points to God's love and his pursuit of us, from the book of Genesis all the way through the book of Revelation. It is a story of God pursuing us out of his intense love for us. It is God's desire for us. It's telling us that God's desire for us is infinitely more than our desire for him. In fact, you'll find in scripture that it says, we love him only because he first loved us. And when you read the scriptures, that's what gets pointed out over and over and over again. And so we have to read all of scripture to understand the extent of God's love. The Bible is God's story of redemption, of restoration, of reconciliation. It's the story of God's creation rebelling against their creator and God making the intentional action of love to bring us back to him, even if we continue to reject him. So that's how Paul's starting this story. And then he continues on in verse 23, where he says, "For from this man's descendants, God has brought to Israel the Savior Jesus as he promised." And it's an interesting piece that Paul's, it's actually a courageous piece that Paul's pointing out. He's calling Jesus of Nazareth, the Savior. The Jewish audience would have heard this as the Messiah, the coming Messiah that they were still hoping for and rejecting even at this point. It would have caused anger in the audience. That was the trepidation that would have come with that. But we see him defining Jesus by the proper term, Savior. And we have to always be careful in our own Christian talk. How do we refer to Jesus? That we refer to him by his titles, that he's Lord and Savior. That we keep that out there in front of people so that they know that. And so God is demonstrating that Jesus is the promise of the Old Testament. that he fulfills all that the prophets and the law had said. He comes from the line of David, which makes him the legitimate king of Israel. It's also the one that would be preached by John the Baptist in the coming verses I'm about to read. And John the Baptist is characterized as the last Old Testament prophet. He bridges the eras of the First Testament and the Second Testament, the Old and the New. He's a cousin of Jesus, actually. And this is what John the Baptist, this is how Paul relates this. He says, before the coming of Jesus, John preached repentance and baptism to all the people of Israel. As John was completing his work, he said, who do you suppose I am? I am not the one you're looking for, but there is one coming after me whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. John the Baptist had this incredibly popular ministry, a huge following, and actually his messages were kind of harsh. We would think they were harsh, but he had a huge following as hearts were ready for this. And he's laying the pathway for others to come to know Jesus when he shows up. So this issue, this message of repentance is still in place even for you today, particularly if you don't know Christ yet, is it's that 180-degree turn where you say, the life I'm living now, I'm going to flip around and I'm going to follow Jesus. And it's going to be an ongoing action in your faith even if you have that. We have to continually do this. He's also talking about baptism, and the baptism that would come from Jesus is an action that the believer takes. It's actually commanded that we publicly profess the work of Jesus Christ in our life by going into the water, under the water and out of it. And he says you have to do this. And there'll be a question about that here in a little bit. But listen to Jesus' words, because this is important what John's preaching, because he's preaching the one that would come, the only one that will matter. Jesus says about himself in a very clear, uncompromising way. He says, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through me. So that's the question for you today, is have you made the decision to follow Christ? There is no other way to the Father, to heaven, in that sense, if you think about it, if that's how you're thinking about it. It has to happen through Jesus. In fact, the only way to have the proper life God designed you to have is through Jesus Christ being the Lord of your life. And then, have you been baptized since you made that decision for Christ? Again, this is a commandment. It's not an option. To not be baptized is actually to walk in continuing disobedience. Knowing that it defines your faith is why you should do it. And so I would implore you today that at the end of this sermon, or even right now, you send an email to that info@calvarylompoc.org and let us know that you're making these decisions, or one or both, so that we can help you along that way. Now we go into the last two sections of this scripture, of this teaching, as Paul's kind of made this transition, just like the Bible makes the transition of Old Testament to John the Baptist to the New Testament, the new covenant established by Christ. He says, fellow children of Abraham, and you God-fearing Gentiles, it is to us that this message of salvation has been sent. The people of Jerusalem and their rulers did not recognize Jesus. Yet in condemning him, they fulfilled the words of the prophet that are read every Sabbath. Though they found no proper ground for a death sentence, they asked Pilate to have him executed. When they had carried out all that was written about him, they took him down from the cross and laid him in a tomb. God raised him from the dead. And for many days he was seen by those who traveled with him from Galilee to Jerusalem. And they are now witnesses to our people. This is an interesting little clarification he gives at the very end of this testimony, of this proof that it's true, Jesus was resurrected. In their minds, they would know who these people were. He's actually saying, you can hold me accountable. You can go check my sources. Here are my sources. In fact, in another letter, Paul lists who they are. So he was validating his message, that his message could be heard from other people who witnessed the same thing. And when we understand this death that he's talking about, being put to death, Jesus knew that was going to happen. In fact, that is why he came to this earth. In the book of Matthew, a verse I'm about to read here in chapter 20, it says that this is the third time he would tell them about his death. And it says, Jesus was going up to Jerusalem. On the way, he took the 12 aside and said to them, "We are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death, and they will hand him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified. On the third day, he'll be raised to life." So Jesus is showing that this is going to be the fact. This is how they will know he's the Lord and Savior, is at his resurrection. And as I've said, and I don't know if I can reiterate it enough, the resurrection is everything. He was raised or he wasn't. Everything that Jesus taught is useless if he wasn't raised. And we're pitied for believing it if he wasn't raised. Yet, Paul tells us in another portion of Scripture, he says, "For what I received, I pass on to you of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures." Remember, he's referring to the Old Testament. "That he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. And he appeared to Cephas, Peter, to the 12, and then it goes on that to hundreds of others afterwards." And so when we talk about the resurrection, what was the cause for the resurrection? Why did that have to happen? Well, first and foremost, to fulfill prophecy laid out, to prove God's faithfulness in that sense, that even though we're culpable in carrying out the crucifixion, all of us, that God had appointed that to take place as well for the forgiveness of our sins. Christ willingly followed that. That's the cause. The characteristics behind this are quite simple, is that Jesus was innocent. In fact, when you read the gospel stories, you find that he was declared innocent twice. And he died a cursed death, according to the Old Testament. To die on a tree, to be hung on a tree, the cross, was a cursed death. That death, the characteristics for that death is he died for the sins of the world. He died for the disobedience. He died for the rejection of God's love through Jesus Christ. In fact, Scripture says, "He who had no sin became sin so that we could be forgiven of sin." The ultimate reality of this, the truth of the resurrection, is that God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. He was in that tomb, and he brought him back to life. It's very symbolic to what Christ is offering you, even here today, that you will become a new creation. Your identity will change the moment you say yes to Jesus Christ. But the power that comes with that faith we find in Ephesians, and I want you to hear this because I get kind of fired up every time I think about it. Paul, again, he's writing to another different church. He says, "I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance to his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come." Now, if I was before a live audience, there'd be some amens going on. Maybe in your house, you said amen right now. But I want you to pay attention to that verse, the God bumps I'm even getting as I read that. The mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead. Here is the promise I give you if you make a decision to follow Christ, to follow Christ today. If you say yes to Jesus, the moment you say that, as he measures your heart, That same mighty power that was exerted to raise Christ from dead is the same mighty power he exerts to put into your life to live the new life he has for you. All that will be available to you. You become a new person. In fact, he says, and I'll tell you this in a little bit by the verse, you become his child. The scripture very specifically says that because we believe, because we've received Jesus Christ, we have the right to be called children of God. And that's why these last two verses of this section make sense to us. He says, we tell you the good news. That's what the word gospel means, good news. What God promised our ancestors, he has fulfilled for us, their children, by raising up Jesus. As it is written in the second psalm, you are my son, today I have become your father. It's a declaration that when you become the son, you become equal. You're equal. And while Jesus has always existed, this is a proclamation of God himself saying, my son's the same as me. Jesus is God. And the added part to this is we join in that inheritance that when we become followers of Christ, as I've already said, we have the right to be called children of God. In fact, what Jesus says himself in his teaching is if we'll follow his ways, if we'll be obedient to him and do his will, in other words, work in this world the way he worked in the world, he says he calls us his brothers, his sisters, and his mothers. We become a family. When you're saved, you're not saved to be by yourself. You're saved into a family of God. You have this whole new identity that's not marked by the consequences of your actions or your experiences. You're not marked by successes. You're not marked by your detriments. You're marked by the love of Jesus Christ. When God looks at you, he sees his son in you, and you're his. That's what was prophesied throughout all of Scripture. That's why the resurrection is so important. And all through Scripture, you keep seeing this in the New Testament, you keep seeing the resurrection being testified to, because that's everything. It was a central piece, as I've already said. And what I implore you today, what I'm asking from you today, is to make that decision. There's nothing else to think about. This is going to be a faith step. If you're looking for further proof, there won't be. There won't be. It's just, it is. Ever pursuing love of God for you to become part of his family, to come back in as he originally designed you to live. So I'm going to say a prayer. I'm going to say a prayer in a little bit. Because the scripture says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart he was raised from the dead, you will be saved. So you see that key piece, raised from the dead. If you will believe that and you will say, yeah, Jesus should be in charge of my life, you'll be saved. And in fact, it says it's in your heart, it's from your heart that you believe and are justified. That means, and that word believe is actually trust. I'm going to trust in this. And then because I'm trusting it, I'll be made right with God. Now, everything's reconciled. Everything's redeemed. Everything's restored to the original design God has for your life. And then it says, and it's with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. So those two things work together. So when I say this prayer, and I say this every week, and if you've been listening on videos, you know this too, the words that I say are not important. They don't make the decision for you. But if my words are echoing what you want to communicate to God, if that's in your heart, then that's what God's actually listening to. Not my words. He's listening to your heart, your inclination to say yes to him. And when I'm done with that prayer, I'll give you some information. How do you go forward with this? So I pray for you. Lord God Almighty, I come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and I thank you for him. I thank you that he died for my sins, even though I've been rejecting him. I thank you that he died for me, even though I've known about him, but I just didn't want him in charge. I didn't want to give up what I had. But Lord, I understand that's death. I don't want that. I want to live for you. I want to live the life you have designed for me. So I ask for your help. I need your forgiveness, and I need you to lead my life. I need to learn how to do that, and I know your church is supposed to help me to do that, and I'll lean on them. So help me, Father, to make the steps necessary to proclaim this. I pray this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. So you see on the screen right now, you see an email address. And I ask you to follow through with that address. Send us, tell us what you did. Tell us where you're at. Or maybe you're just not quite there yet and you want to communicate that and you have some more questions. And that email will come to me and I'll answer those personally for you. Whether it's email, text, phone, whatever it has to happen, I'll do that. If you need to be baptized, that's the email. Let us know. It's time to be baptized, and we'll figure that out. We're going to have to be creative, but we'll figure it out. Because it's a commandment of God, we need to do that. And again, when the time comes and we can regather, it's going to be a celebration. And we'll be able to celebrate you in a community for the decisions you made during these times of shelter in place. So again, Resurrection Day, I hope that this is the day that your life was resurrected. You became one with Jesus Christ. You became part of the family of God. In fact, you assumed the right to be called a child of God because you believed and you received. So I'm going to say the benediction to end this portion. And I thank you again on this day that you joined us. And I pray for you and will continue to pray for you during this time. Let me say it. Father God, you are the Lord God Almighty, the creator of all things that we know and we don't know, and you pursue us relentlessly, even in our rejection. And Jesus Christ, who came to dwell among us, to die, to be buried, and to be resurrected for the forgiveness of our sins. And the Holy Spirit, who is the mighty power that comes into our life to help us live a life that brings you honor for the rest of our days. May he be evident in all that you say, all that you do, and all that you think. God bless you. Thank you for being with us. Go give them heaven.
Hey, thank you for joining us this morning as we worship our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, here at CalvaryLompoc.org or wherever you found us on YouTube. We are here to serve you and to serve your family and to help you follow Jesus in a relationship with him. If you would like more information about the church, you can find it on our website at CalvaryLompoc.org. You can find past sermons there and information about our regular ministries that go on, as well as how to contact the church. If you have any prayer needs or other needs that are going on, also please let us know. We would love to be praying for you or helping to figure out how we can serve you. I don't know if we can find you toilet paper, but we'll do whatever we can to help you out. And you can contact us at info@calvarylompoc.org. Our family is just here to serve you and care for you and lift up Jesus Christ and help you connect with him as well. Calvary family, if you'd like to give, you can give online at our website. You can find the links there on the front page and how to give online and do that, or you can mail a check into the office, whatever works best for you. But that's just for our Calvary family. If you're new to Calvary, you are our guest today, and we're just so glad that you've worshiped with us. If you've received Christ today or you want to know more information about following them, also please give us a call at our office number. You can find it on the website, or it's 805-733-3545, or give us an email again at info@calvarylompoc.org. We'd love to help you understand more about what it means to follow Christ. Anyway, it's a beautiful Easter day. We are glad that you've worshiped with us, and we look forward to connecting with you again next week. God bless you.